All right. So I've got a selection of stones here. All the stuff I'm going to need to finish sharpening these will look up for one last step after I'm done with the stones. But I'm going to talk about the stones that I use here. I'll get to that in one second. I use Japanese-style stones, water stones. These ones here are synthetic. You can get natural ones, but they're really expensive. And I don't really think it matters. Maybe on the very last polishing stone, you know, it might. I mean, this one is really going to make a difference anyway, right? You don't need to buy really high-end, expensive, coarse stones. Although my polishing stone here, this Norton, and I've had it for a long, long time, but it was $92 like 10 years ago or something. But worth every penny. That is 10 times better than these stones here. I think these ones are called Lobster Stone, I think was the brand. Anyway, I got two of these. This one is 800 grit. And this one, I think, is 12. I just wrote it on the side here with a pencil, and you can see that, you know, the 800 is worn a lot more. It does most of the heavy lifting. Anyway, so what we want to do, and it matters a lot less for these than it would if you're doing like a plain iron or a chisel or something that really needs to have if you want a nice square flat edge. You want to make these things true, and you should keep them up, otherwise they start getting kind of swaybacked here. Maybe a little bit I'll pull out I've got some old oil stones that have been, they've gone through they made a lot of things sharp over their lifetime. Anyway, so there's a technique that they use when they're creating precision surface plates and by hand scraping. And if you take three surfaces, the only way three surfaces can all mate perfectly flat together is if they're all perfectly flat, right? So if you have, you know, this one's flat and this one's curved like this, well, it's gonna rock, right? If it was curved this way, well, then you're gonna be sitting high, you know, on the points. Flat, of course, is flat. Well, let's say you get one that's curved this way and one that's curved that way. Well, they might fit together perfectly. But if you take a third one that would be, say, either flat or curved like one of these others, well, it won't mate together. So it's a way of averaging out the irregularities, and, you know, you can make them flat. But with stones, it's really easy because, you know, these things are, they're designed to be kind of soft, and they will erode quickly. So that means you're constantly getting new sharp stuff doing the work for you. So I don't know if you can see this here. I'll try to draw, but I just got a pencil, cheapy pencil. I just draw some lines on the stones here, so we got some witness marks. Let's see. Necessary, but I usually do it just to make sure I've gotten everywhere. Oh, I got that surface. Using that one there. So, normally I do this in the sink, but we'll do it right here. So I get a little water on there and just kind of rub them together. You don't have to press on them real hard. Just rub them. And if you watch, you can see dirty brown nasty stuff kind of dripping off of here. Okay, and you can see they're high on the outside, which rinse them off. So you can see we got hash marks still there in the center. So both of these have gotten scooped out in the center because, you know, that's where most of the work is going on, is in the middle, so of course they usually tend to wear that way. So we'll rub these here some more. And if you do this like every time you use these, it's a lot less. If you, and believe me, you know, I've done it before, get lazy. And it's actually been a couple of times since I've done them. This may take a little while. Can't see any lines on that face. That was the face I was using, right? Oh yeah. Yeah, see how they get like suction, I can almost pick it up. Get it right. Yeah, see the vacuum on there will hold it together. Okay. So what we're gonna do now, we're gonna mark these faces again. Get our third stone in here. Lighting very good in here. And if we're lucky, that stone and these stones will both be pretty true, and this won't take too long. But if things are really out of shape, then it's going to take a little while. So, I think I'm going to call this, you know, this is my medium stone, but we'll call it the reference, I guess, for now. So we've mated this one to that one already. So whether they're flat or curved, you know, they're mated. And I don't think I mentioned it before, but the medium and coarse stones are supposed to be kept in water all the time because they soak up the water, and, you know, if you let them dry out, then you got to wait for them to saturate again. The fine stone is different. It's kind of impermeable, if you leave it in the water, it'll actually start to kind of like degrade. It almost turns to like clay. The bad stuff to. Oh. So I can see I've been working on this side. Probably been working on both sides actually. I see a pencil line on that side as well. Just go with that. Like I said, this is a Norton stone, and I really, really recommend them. I know they're very expensive, but this stone really hasn't lost, very, very little. And it cuts really fast. And even though it's very fine, like, you know, a coarse stone is 800, well, this is 8,000. So that's a very fine stone. Feel like it's not rubbing good, so it means we're hitting on some high points there somewhere. When I finally do wear out these other stones, I'm going to replace them with Norton stones. Okay, so we can see this one here. See the pattern, we're wearing it out in the middle. So we'll just keep going here until we get everything made it to this stone. Then we're going to take that one and mate it back to this stone again. probably only ever go do. I only sharpen stuff maybe once or twice a year. I don't seem to really dull out stuff. Probably I'm not working enough, I guess, huh? That's what Bob keeps telling me. You can see out here at the very corners, there's a little bit more could come off on that. I'm going to leave that kind of just as a witness. You know, like there's still a little hash on that one, so I know which side I'm working on. Okay, so we've got to mark this stone again. This stone to that one, which now, right now, this one matches that one. So we're going to be kind of averaging between this face and that face onto this face. So this is how it, that's how it works. Okay, so those match. This one was the standard before, so we're going to make this other one the standard. Alright, so we average this one to that one. Actually, I should run this one onto that one again. Yeah, I don't think that matters. So we're going to put this face, mark it. This face here, which we just matched to that stone. Well, I'm getting ready to dip my pencil into the water. Mark this stone here. About the very corners. I'm not going to be sharpening anything out there. But probably we're going to wear away some more of this stone. We're likely it'll get out there anyway. much left on that. You can see it looks like we got all the way out to the corners on that one now. So, you don't necessarily always want to take it all the way down. Okay, I want to see just a little of shadow. This one, so we're gonna match this one to this one. This is a leveling stone, right? Or flattening stone, they call it. You're supposed to take this, you know, you just rub it against these, and it'll grind them. This is really hard. It doesn't wear very fast, but it will wear. You know, everything wears. It doesn't matter what you think. It's going to wear some. But I don't like it. It leaves a really coarse texture on the surface of the stone. I mean, you can see these are very sort of satin kind of a look. You know, they're rubbing them together. I guess if you had one that was really, really out of shape, you could use that, but in all honesty, it's kind of a waste of money. I don't know what I paid for that. Well, this is a Norton product, actually, but anyway, I've seen people do this. I've done that in the past, but I didn't care for the results. Or a piece of plate glass, they'll put sandpaper on there. That's another sharpening technique you could use, really, that way. There's more than one way to do things, I guess. Okay, now this guy's going to be the standard. Let's start out with this stone. like this always makes me think I should build some kind of a machine to do this. Mark that again because we're going to just use it now. But I do need to mark this one. I suppose I probably really wouldn't need 3 stones if I didn't use this technique. For the most part, I usually just use the coarse stone and the, if it's really not hardly, it's just a little dull and just needs a little dress up, I'll use that medium stone. For the most part, it's just the polishing stone and the coarse stone. Got it. Okay, so now something about this polishing stone. It's good to have a little bit of a slurry on it. I know that's sort of counterintuitive because you always hear that you get a slurry on your stone and the knife is, you can liken it to like dragging it through mud. If you're on an oil stone, you got stone aggregate or whatever building on it was, it's going polishing this face while you've got grit grinding on the other side as it's flowing over it. But I don't know, this is the conventional wisdom with water stones. So you just rub them together a little bit and it'll create a little bit of slurry, and I'll just leave that on it. As I use it, it's going to generate some anyway. So set that over there. That's ready to go. Okay, so now I got the stones are all prepared. And I know that took a really long time, but I've been delinquent in my servicing. So anyway, next step is going to be doing the primary bevel on the blades. So I'll get all set up and we'll come back and do that.